Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.
Hello. Welcome to the Council on Chemical Abuse Drug and Alcohol Update. February is Black History Month. Black communities experience traumatic events at a higher rate than other racial groups. The phenomenon of historical trauma, race-based trauma, and intergenerational trauma all contribute to high incidences. When trauma is undiagnosed and or untreated, other sociological, physical, and or mental conditions can occur. Incidents of violence, deterioration of physical health, and poor health behaviors can attribute to trauma. People of color face higher rates of substance use, as well as abuse, as well different from their white counterparts. Yet, they are less likely to access treatment. Other data tells us that Black African-American adults had 20% more likely to experience mental health issues than the rest of the population, yet only 1 in 3 Black people need mental health care, receive it. Suicide rates are higher than Black people, especially teenagers, and African-American teenagers are more likely to attempt suicide than are white teenagers. So with me more to talk more about this and the impact that it has in the African-American communities, I've invited members from Caron Treatment Counseling Services, and I'm going to ask them to introduce themselves as they pop up on the screen for me. So Dr. Roberts, good afternoon. Can you introduce yourself, please?
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Ramona Roberts. I'm the Senior Executive Director for the Regional Outpatient Services for Caron.
Thank you. Thank you for joining me today. And Shannon Tissera, I'm hoping I'm saying your name correctly.
You did. Hi, I'm Shannon Tissera. I'm one of the outpatient therapists here at COTC.
Wonderful. And last but not least, Greg, Mr. Greg Day, how are you today? Can you introduce yourself?
Absolutely. Hi, I'm Gregory Day, the lead clinical therapist at Caron Outpatient Treatment Centers.
So I brought the collective here, the collective of experts who really talk and deal with individuals that are seeking treatment. And we want to really just kind of lay the foundation and talk about how treatment looks, addiction treatment, and how it can look a little bit differently based on an individual's culture. Given that February is Black History Month, we really thought that we would kind of take a look at what's been happening within our Black communities. Talk a little bit about generational trauma, historical trauma, and the incidences from those trauma and how when they're not treated appropriately, it can lead to further other dynamics in our communities, such as violence, such as crime, such as substance use and misuse. And we really want to kind of share from a perspective of the work that you do, how people can access the help and the treatment that they viably need. So I'm wondering if you guys could just kind of give me your insight. Dr. Ramona, let's start with you first, just in terms of why the specialization in that type of delivery of service for treatment? You know, some people would say, is it that serious? You know, that one size fit all, isn't that enough?
Appreciate the question. And it's not enough, right? One size doesn't fit all. We know that really with therapy in general. And when we look at, we're taught, so I also teach master's level and doctorate level and even undergraduate level courses. And we teach in the one required multicultural class, right? Most programs, there's one course for it. And we teach that there's a pre-termination rate for people of color, it's 50%. And it hovers around 30% for white people. So that's a remarkably high number, which means pre-termination rate for our audience just means that they're dropping out of treatment before they meet their needs, their goals. And there's a number of reasons for that. We've got stigma. We've got what it means in the population of people of color. We've got inability to pay obstacles, transportation. We have the issue of being harmed in therapy. So, you know, there's a number of experiences that can happen, aggression experiences, microaggression experiences that can happen in the therapy setting. So it's not enough for us just to learn about it in school. We've got to have some action to then do something about that number. I think we don't exist in a vacuum. Counseling and therapy does not exist in a vacuum. We're not isolated from the socio-political influences of our everyday social climate. So we need to take in the instances of racism and discrimination and oppression, and the intergenerational trauma, which is people feeling and experiencing things that symptoms from things that they've actually never had firsthand experience with. We know that from the enslavement of African Americans, right? From the displacement of indigenous people. You name it, we could get a number of things. I know the Holocaust survivors have been a wide area of research for the intergenerational trauma. And so we're passing things down. When it's not recognized, acknowledged, trauma is going to be passed down at the genetic and biological level.
Yeah, and I'm going to even go so far as to ask the question, and Greg, this would be for you. And so when we don't talk about the trauma, right, it's kind of, if you will, absorbed within the communities. And the way that it's talked about, it's kind of in a deference in terms of saying, well, look at that or look at this. Sure. And Greg, in the work, can you just kind of talk a little bit about the work that you do? And I particularly know that you work with adolescents and how that can transcend when that information isn't really shared in the spirit that it perhaps could be.
So, Yvonne, I've kind of transitioned from the adolescent work, but to answer your question, you're absolutely right. Often when it comes to racial trauma, and quite frankly, you really don't hear that term as much as you should. More or less, we kind of, when we talk about racial trauma, we really kind of just skim the surface of it, okay? We don't really get into the meat and bones of what the emotional experience of it has been or is for an individual of color. And historically speaking, that has been our practice, that has been our experience for generations. But those emotions, those feelings have to go somewhere. I can think of a time, you know, back in the 80s when I just moved to Pennsylvania, originally from Baltimore, Maryland, which was a culture shock and shift all at once, right? I remember going into one of the department stores with my mom, and for whatever reason, when I would walk past a white person, right, I would always put my head down and move out of the way. And my mom would always question me about it, like, Greg, what is that about? And I never had an answer for it. I never had an answer. So recently I just went back to school and I bring up this point to kind of show you how racial trauma just, it sits and it kind of like overflows at some point, right? Going back to school, I wrote a paper about it and I felt myself welling up and getting emotional. And thank God that I had that experience. And that's what we need to be able to tap into. We need to be able to tap into our emotions as it relates to racial trauma. A quick stat I want to share with you. Black children on average, right? On average encounter 5 racial discriminations per day. Now just think about social media, school, whether it be microaggression, something they hear. Those feelings, those emotions have to go somewhere. And most of us, it's been our method of dealing with it is to just kind of gloss over and not deal with it.
Yeah, and when we don't deal with our feelings, they show up in other ways.
Absolutely.
And so I'm wondering if you or Shannon or even Dr. Roberts just kind of want to mention about, you know, we talked about data in terms of suicide rates. We talk about data in the way of crime and violence. We talk about data in the way of substance use and misuse. And those are transcending of communications to say, I don't know how to deal with this. I've never received any appropriate acknowledgement of it, first of all, much less coping skills. So I'm going to do the best that I can, and I'm just going to harm myself or harm somebody else. Anyone want to? Shannon, you want to tackle that?
Yeah, actually, I was just asked this question yesterday, what the difference was between having this group specific for people of color and people that identify in the BIPOC population versus any other group. Would that segregate these individuals more? Would it ostracize these individuals more? And I think that the answer is just simply no. This work really is meant to facilitate and foster a space of healing and of growth for these individuals. similar to how Greg mentioned his experience, I feel like I've experienced several different instances of microaggressions or discrimination in general where I was not able to express my feelings or kind of work through these emotions, where that's the foundation of our work here, is to be able to facilitate a space where we can work through these emotions, identify them even, where some people can't place name to some of these emotions. And that's what I'm most excited about.
And I appreciate you saying how to identify with the emotions, because you know that you're feeling something. And sometimes you don't know, particularly growing up, you don't know what it is. You just know that you're feeling something, right? And so where do we go with that? How do we put a label on it? How do we identify it? And then how do we deal with it? So that brings me then to my next question, because I was just, when I first learned about this, fascinated by it, ethnodrama. So let's talk about ethnodrama, what it is, how does that process work, and really being from a place of being culturally sensitive, because that's, I think that's appropriate approach. What does that look like?
That's an experiential trauma group. The term ethnodrama could throw people off, because it was a term that was coined, specifically using psychodrama. There's another term, ethnotherapy, coined by Dr. Cobbs, who wrote Black Rage. So there's a number of terms that we tossed around as we were creating this, and we stuck with ethnodrama. We want to make sure, though, that we explain it's a mix, a blend of a number of modalities. Mm-hmm. So we are going to use the psychodrama. We're going to use the sociometry as part of that term. We're also going to add in components of art and music, food even. One of our favorite trainers and teachers out there and clinicians is Rezma Menekem. He talks very much about being with people rather than focusing necessarily on tips and answers. And we really appreciate that, because I think one of the biggest standout points, highlights of this group is really the setting to be able to, Shannon kind of alluded to it already, but like the validation piece. Mm-hmm. Back to that stat about pre-termination rates, I think the validation piece is big. So being able to go into a therapy room, and I know Greg can probably talk a little more about this, about how therapy wasn't designed for people of color, right? But you go into a therapy room, and I'm a white clinician. And let's say Greg were my patient, and he tells me about something that happened to him. I can invalidate him in my response of, well, what was your tone? Or maybe you're reading too much into it. Because now I'm questioning Greg's reality. And Greg, as a person of color himself, his reality is probably a lot more spot on than mine, right?
So if I could just add, the ethnodrama group, it truly is going to be about healing. It's going to be about getting in touch with these wounds, as well as, Yvonne, community. We don't have to do this on our own anymore. This is going to give a safe place where we can address issues that have been overlooked for generations.
And so I appreciate the explanation about the psychodrama, the art, the food. Why are those approaches important and conversive of, in a group that says, well, how are we doing today? Right? Or let's watch a movie and pick out the parts of it that you can resonate with. What is the difference in terms of ethnodrama versus those psychoeducational groups?
So this is going to be an interactive experience. This is going to be the virtual reality of group therapy. It's not going to be about sitting and talking. It's actually going to be about being actually in the experience or the moment. So it's going to be some laughter. There's going to be some anger. This is going to be an opportunity to embrace pain as well as shed some tears. But like I said, this is going to be about the community. This is going to be about all of us having this experience together.
And if I may add as well, I think it's important to bring in the aspects that matter most to these communities, being able to meet them where they're at. And so many different cultures, art and food specifically, are the heart of these cultures. So being able to share that with each other, I think, is so special, and will really bring a sense of intimacy to the group as well.
And if we see a lot of commercials right now because it is Black History Month talking about these things, right? And I think one of the commercials I keep seeing on repeat talks about storytelling, right? Storytelling for people of color and the art and the music. These are things, you know, that are very deep rooted. It's not your traditional, let's go into the therapy session and talk about emotions. So Greg's talking about, we want to process those emotions, right? But that's not always done at the verbal level. Mm-hmm. And how this racial trauma and intergenerational trauma shows up, sometimes it's in ways that people don't necessarily think need to come into the therapy room, mm-hmm. right? So high blood pressure, fibroids, there's a lot of medical experiences, stomach aches, chest pains, right? A lot of physiological experiences, headaches, and those can be the alert to, hey, there's something more going on there. It might not be they might not be as freely able to identify the emotional word, the emotional label for it. We know from, I think it's still the number one book out there, Bessel van der Kolk's book, that its title is The Body Keeps the Score, right? So we know it keeps the score. And like I mentioned, one of our favorite trainers, I'm very much into somatic approaches. So we know that interactive experience with the body, experience moving about, even with hypervigilance, being on guard all the time because you're constantly looking out for that threat, and seeing how that shows up in the body. And how do you calm that and allow your body to know that you are in a space that is maybe, let's say, safe enough, right? So I think it involves a lot of things.
And it sounds like it in its entirety, in its in some ways complexity, it would call for a select number of folks, you know, in terms of, like, you know, there have been some, as a person in long-term recovery, I've been part of therapy groups where there's been like 10 or 12 people, and because of the 2 hours, you might get a word in edgewise. But it sounds like this, Greg, really involves everyone's participation to the fullest. And so my question would be, is that going to be a smaller group? And then how do you determine who's most appropriate for it?
So we're actually currently working on various assessments. We're putting together assessments to kind of determine who is appropriate for this group, for this particular group. And also, to your point, you know, we might just have a few people in the experience that's going on in group, but the entire group will be able to identify and share their experience with what the topic of the group may be that particular day.
We also made sure in the setup, Yvonne, that we thought a lot about the cohesion. Mm-hmm. That's a challenge for clinicians everywhere, right? Especially when we have open group situations, which for the viewer means you have a rolling admission. People can come in at any time. We start off with these five. Well, two of them leave and we get three more, and it keeps going. And that can be a real challenge for any, even seasoned clinicians. For this group, because we know it's much more specialized and it's going to take a lot more care, we set it up in a closed session format. So we're going to run it in 10-week cohorts. Now, the first five people that start in our very first cohort, maybe three of them want to go in the second cohort. And that's okay. People can go for more. They will now start with new folks. And this way, it will lower some of their own defenses, their walls that are up, wondering, can we trust this person? Who's this newbie? Do I have to share all over again? And we think that will help facilitate an environment where they're able to do a lot more work.
Well, I appreciate, and again, going back to just kind of some of my experiences, whereby you talked about having a cohesive group that can kind of walk through this together. And if you could talk a little bit more about, I don't know if the research talks about the opportunity for people staying committed that much longer to their own treatment versus sometimes people feel like I'm feeling a little bit outsider, and so I'm not going to continue to come, and we shorten our own treatment. We shorten our own wellness as a barrier because we just don't feel like we fit, right? That's not a best fit for us. So have you been able to, from the research of endotrauma, talk about how the outcomes can really help individuals tap into their own illness, right, and their own trauma with an understanding of they're in this to get well?
I think a big piece of go ahead. I was just going to say, I think a big piece of that is will probably be being able to provide a safe place as well as building rapport. I think when people are able to build rapport with the therapist, the facilitator, as well as the group members, hence the idea of making it a closed group, okay, I think that'll touch on the longevity of their, you know, their willingness to stay in group for a period, a longer period of time.
And I need to just kind of mention for those that might be listening to this saying, well, as a therapist, perhaps I could do this. This is specialized training. This isn't something that we just kind of pick up a book and maybe respond to a couple questions and boom, now we are, right, endodrama trained. But this is specialized training that both of you, all three of you have actually encountered.
Well, and if I could just add to that, you're absolutely right. I mean, we've been through, you know, about 6 months of experiential training. But also, Yvonne, myself and Shannon, we've experienced this trauma as well, too. So we're empathetic to what we're getting ready to dive into right now.
Yeah, which is going to add another layer, quite frankly. You know, I was part of a talk yesterday, and it was just kind of talking about the field, the drug and alcohol field, and the importance of people need to see people like us. People need to see people in recovery that are people of color, as well as clinicians that are people of color, because I think sometimes those are some of the barriers that when people are hesitant about accessing treatment, again, that unspoken trauma comes to surface and saying, well, what would you know about my walk that would make me even disclose any type of information to you? And it's a continued barrier all along the way, to the point that I actually feel like they're being punished to some degree, and so I'm not going to commit to this fully because I'm really not sure what your angle is on this.
And historically speaking, people of color have not been open to therapy. I mean, you think about things such as the Tuskegee experience, you know, things such as that. Therapy wasn't designed for us. So I think having, you know, people of color facilitating it will also, like you just said, peel back certain layers. There was a quote that I love from Jay-Z, and Jay-Z said that Black folks are more scared of therapy than they are the police. And that's heavy. I mean, for years, you know, we keep things in-house, and we're a very private people, okay? And there's been this misconception that therapy is a sign of weakness. But then you look at celebrities today that are just speaking out on mental health. You have people like the rapper Common, Brandon Marshall, football players, are now speaking out about mental health and the importance of it. So it's been a shift in regards to our feelings and the stigma that's related to mental health.
Hey, absolutely. Shannon, I did you want to say something to that? I saw that you didn't want to just miss anything that you might have to say.
This is the best part of our work, is taking one step further to breaking down the stigma that is centered around people of color accessing mental health. We talked about accessibility and equality even in therapy settings. So to be a part of that is the most amazing and honorable work.
Thank you for that.
And I do appreciate Yvonne saying about training and so forth, that this is something where the training, it doesn't just end here. You take a couple of classes, read a couple of books, right? This is something that's ongoing. Shannon and Greg and myself, we will continually be engaging in trainings with some of our favorite folks, Dr. Ken Hardy, Dr. Robert Carter, Dr. Monica Williams, Dr. Kent Butler. These are all names we should be learning from in the field and adding to training proper supervision. Mm-hmm. So they need to be able to have a space to talk about, as Greg shared, the two of them are going to have different experiences than I did in helping design this group, right? And I'm not the therapist for the group, but they're going to need a space to be able to talk about what comes up for them going through this group as well. So supervision and training, very important.
Yeah, that's really key, Dr. Roberts. I agree with you in the way of, as you approach the work, making sure, and we do this even in, you know, as certified recovery specialists, as, you know, peer support specialists, that we make sure that we continue our own professional development, but also in the way of making sure that we're doing those next right things for our own well-being and our own spiritual, mental wellness overall is also, that's really key. That's very key. I'm wondering if you can kind of talk about the next steps, the rollout. What does that look like in terms of time frame? And then how do we alert the community at large that Ethnodrama is something, a practice that's available?
I would love your help in alerting the community at large. We have a flyer that is almost done. It should be out next week. We're trying to get in any outlet we can, any social media we can, any meetings we can with community providers. Right now, we are accepting referrals for this group. It's going to launch in March. We want to make sure we get a few people to launch with because we don't want to start too soon or too late that we're missing out on some immediate referrals or that we're, we just want to make sure that people get to come in and have this opportunity. So we're trying to get the word out this far in advance. You can call our main number at 484-345-4670. That's our front office number to get scheduled. Whether you're coming in with primary substance use related to your experiences with racial trauma and intergenerational trauma, or if you're coming in with your primary mental health, because we have both licenses. So they can call that main number and get set up with an appointment. The flyers and, you know, just conversations like this to get people, to get the word out. We want to know any obstacles, financial, we should not have any obstacles around that. Even transportation, I've heard some people buzzing in the ear. If you have people that have transportation needs, let us know, because this is a good group. We want to see people to be able to get this. So,
is there a formidable assessment? If somebody calls, there's an appointment to do an assessment to determine appropriateness for the group. Am I correct in saying that?
Yes, they would get an initial evaluation, much like all of our other patients, they get an initial evaluation, and then they'll have some assessment questions to see if they're an appropriate candidate. Now, if they're an appropriate candidate for this group, then we will have them actually get set up with a session with Shannon or Greg to then explore further, making sure this is really the right space for them, the right fit on both ends.
Because, and I guess the other thing I'm thinking, because that assessment might determine that maybe they need something a little bit more. I'm just kind of thinking maybe inpatient first and then, okay. And so insurance cover this, or is this, can this be part, this is part of the treatment, right? Treatment that would include insurance could cover this.
Yeah, so because we run this it's very much intertwined with their substance use. So whatever insurance they'd be using for their substance use, this is going to target that, or their primary mental health. You know, they have depression, anxiety, a PTSD diagnosis. So we take a number of commercial insurances, probably double digits there. We also do take Berks County Medicaid, and we are contracted with your Council on Chemical Abuse. So again, we do have that option for people that don't have insurance. And you're right, we would assess like normal. So if someone presents, they hear about this group and like, I want to do this group. This sounds right up my alley. but they get an evaluation and we realize their substance use needs a higher level of care, we're going to absolutely make sure that they get that recommendation first. And then when they step down a level to our outpatient care, they can be involved in that group when appropriate.
And then what can someone expect in the way of participating in this group? Is there anything beyond they complete 10 weeks and then what's next? Is there any thought to that? Is there, you know, sometimes I know that you guys have like recovery groups for folks after they've kind of successfully completed. And just was wondering, any thought to that?
So Yvonne, that's probably still in the works. But after the 10 weeks, maybe folks do want to continue. And that might be an opportunity to continue maybe in just some individual work as well with myself or either Shannon.
Yeah. And Shannon, maybe you could talk a little bit about that recovery maintenance group, because that is a group that Shannon runs.
Absolutely. So the recovery maintenance group is the perfect step down for a continuum of care for so many individuals, just to keep that sense of community. And I know so many of the group members always say it's an elective group, so they don't have to remain in the group for a certain amount of time. They can elect to stay in it for 6 weeks to multiple months if that's the kind of care that they need. And it's a great, like I said, a great step down continuum of care.
And I just think this is just a wonderful opportunity to, you know, growing up, I always heard it takes a village, right? And so going to coin something that Greg mentioned, that same community effort, that same community input, I think could be very, very helpful in someone's healing. When we talk about trauma, we know that it's widespread in the Black communities, right? We heard the statistics, we heard about the data, and then we know that in order for us to do a healing, a holistic healing, it's going to mean that all community partners need to come to the table. So I'm really appreciative of that effort and you saying that. I'm wondering, we talked about calling for an assessment. Can someone give us a phone number to call?
I'm probably the one that knows it off the top of my head, right? 484-345-4670 is our main front office line to get an assessment. You can reach out to any one of us. If you have additional questions about the group, you can go on the Caron website and get our contact information. It's all pretty simple, though. So each one of us, it's our first initial and last name. So I'm rroberts@caron.org. So the same for Shannon and Gray. You can reach out to us, and we'd be happy to elaborate on the group. If you think you have a potential referral, but you want to talk it through a little more, or if you're someone who thinks you want the group for yourself and you just want more information, feel free to reach out to us. We really want that community and collective healing. So as many other community providers that can be involved with us, even when we mention food, restaurants who want to be a part of this experience.
And this is for, I'm sorry, I should have made this clear earlier. This is for adults, right? At this time, any Ethnodrama for youth or adolescents, not that's in the works down the road?
So they're at the Ethnodrama group, right, is for adults right now. This is our pilot group. So we'll see how this goes, see what this looks like. And if we do have teenagers, because, you know, Greg mentioning that earlier about the 5 experiences per day. I mean, so we've got to do something for teens. We can't just say you can't go to group because you're not an adult, right? So we do have teen groups here. Shannon actually is the facilitator of our teen intensive outpatient program now. But we also have an opportunity to bring teens in for individual trauma work. We do have a lot of EMDR providers. Gregory and Shannon are both EMDR trained themselves. So we can still assist a teen, just not in the same group way. And we might use some of the same modalities we would there, just not with all the peers.
Awesome. Wonderful. Well, this has really been a worthwhile conversation. I'm really appreciative of Dr. Roberts, Greg Day, and Shannon Tissera, your time and your expertise that you're bringing to the table. And just want to remind our home viewers that if you have any questions about the Council on Chemical Abuse, you're welcome to give us a call at 610-376-8669 or visit our website at cocaberks.org. This has been the Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update. Again, I want to thank my guests for a wonderful conversation. We want to wish the greater Berks County a very happy Valentine's Day, and an even better, happy Black History Month, and be well till next time. Thank you.
The Council on Chemical Abuse, Drug and Alcohol Update on BCTV is supported by the Council on Chemical Abuse.